Hi everyone, welcome to our webinar, Endpoint Security, Bolster Defenses Against Stealthy Attacks. This is the fourth in our series of endpoint security focused webinars, and we're holding them every 2 weeks on Thursday at this time. Thanks for joining today. Before we move to our presentation, just a couple of quick things that we need to cover. If you want to ask a question, click on the Ask a Question button on the bottom left of your screen. We'll answer questions as we go along and at the end as well. The Attachments tab houses collateral and links to useful information, including the slides from today's session. At the end of the webinar, please take a moment to rate and provide your feedback in the Rate This button. And we will have polling questions in this webinar. The poll questions will appear under the Vote tab when we launch them later in the webinar. We'll let you know when those are live, and we hope you'll participate. Finally, the webinar is being recorded, and you can access it anytime using the same link used to connect to our session today. Now, with that out of the way, let's do some introductions. My name is Esther Seguin, and I'm Endpoint Marketing for Symantec, and I will be your moderator. Our presenters are Roi Abitboul, Head of Threat Defense, Symantec Endpoint Security, and Carlos Christos, he's Technical Director of Symantec Endpoint Security. Hi, Roi and Carlos. How are you today?
Hey, Esther. Very good.
Thank you for having us. Good afternoon.
I'm ready for a very informative session. And I know that we have a full schedule today, so I'm going to turn the floor over to you, Roi, and you can kick things off.
Sure, let's do it. So can you see my slides? Awesome.
We're all set.
Yeah, so just a couple of, I want to say a couple of words kind of in a background of my background. So I was the CEO and co-founder of Javelin Networks. And after the acquisition, after Symantec acquisition, basically my role is to lead the Threat Defense for Active Directory group here in Broadcom. I served in the Israeli Defense Forces and for 7 years, and all what we did is security, mainly post-exploitation. So that's what we know best, and that's what our main expertise is. Just moving forward to the slides. Basically, what we're going to talk today is about Threat Defense for Active Directory, Security for Active Directory. But the main differentiator with this solution is that we protect Active Directory, but we do it from the endpoint. That's the main differentiator. Other companies basically would do it from the Active Directory itself. And the problem with that approach is they are, very late into the attack cycle. By having the protection, the defense at the endpoint where the attack starts, you have the upper hand and you really have the ability to stop the attack before the attackers try able to move laterally and spread in the environment. So Active Directory is being used in probably everywhere. Every enterprise using, Active Directory. And as the slide mentioned, 90% of all the organization out there are using Active Directory. Now, from the other side of the equation, the attackers, I would say that most of APTs or all the APTs are based on the fact that organization are using Active Directory. So let me try to kind of explain it a little bit further. So if you look at the screen, you see that all the APTs, a lot of them are really, still ongoing, very recent. And what is being marked here is the post-exploitation part. What do I mean by that is what happens after attackers manage to penetrate the organization, manage to get a foothold on one of the endpoints, for example. So the common ground for all the APTs that you see here is that all of them here use to manipulate the Active Directory after the attacker managed to penetrate the organization. That's kind of one of the real or the first or the basic message that I want to deliver here, that post-exploitation is really based on Active Directory manipulation. And that's something that's really important to understand and to remember. Now,
another great thing to point out on the previous slide with the APTs, right, is we all are aware of the SolarWind thing that's gone down over the last few months, and it uses, right, components specifically of APT29 and Cozy Bear. And so these things have existed for quite some time, but there's still difficulty, right, in being able to stop some of the basic procedures that they go through against Active Directory, which we'll see today.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you, Carlos. Again, Active Directory is here with us for the last 20 years. And you see that, you know, the last, I would say, 5 or 6 years, all the APTs are really using it in a more extensive way. And I want to kind of try to explain why is that, why Active Directory is being used by attackers so much. And the problem is that at the end of the day, you know, Active Directory is just a database. But it's a database that contains all the information about the entire organization. So all the information about all the PCs, the apps, the, you know, users, groups, everything is there. And the problem is that it's by design exposed from every endpoint. So literally from every endpoint that connected to the domain, attackers can just ask the Active Directory and be able to get 100% visibility to that database. They can easily just ask the Active Directory, hey, you know, tell me about all the powerful users here. Immediately, Active Directory will answer back. Same thing for all the other information that, you know, Active Directory holds. Now,
so Roi, before you start going through that, I'm going to kick off a poll here. Mm-hmm. In the last year, has your organization experienced any of these, a red team test where they were compromised, a pen test where the Active Directory was compromised, or a vulnerability assessment that uncovered issues with Active Directory, or none of these?
Thank you, Esther. I just want to say to the crowd that, you know, just a comment. A lot of those red teamers' business model, you know, business model is based on, you know, finding and creating or simulating the attack. And a lot of them are using Active Directory to do that, to spread, to move laterally, to steal credentials, to access the DC and all of that. So just, you know, wondering to hear your thoughts if you kind of had something like that on your organization. May I move forward?
Yep. Okay. Awesome. It looks like nobody had everyone. We have 100% answering none of the above. Okay. So go ahead.
Cool. So, let's kind of work on how the attack starts and what happens and what the attackers are actually after when they manage to penetrate one of your endpoints. So after the attackers got a foothold on one of the endpoints, basically it takes 7 minutes for them to achieve a full enterprise dominance or full or total domain dominance. And this is done by be able to steal domain admin. So it literally takes just 7 minutes from the point the attackers got a foothold on one of your endpoints to the point that they have control your entire organization. And as I mentioned, that's kind of done by the Active Directory reconnaissance that, as I mentioned, is by design exposed, that information there is exposed from every endpoint, and spreading, that moving laterally into those assets or into those places inside your organization that the attacker is actually able to and gain domain dominance or domain admin. So basically,
Roi, we have one more poll question. It might be a good time to bring this up, just to ask the audience, what has been your experience with attackers and their pursuit of Active Directory? Attackers tried to penetrate an endpoint but were unsuccessful. Attackers penetrated an endpoint and conducted reconnaissance but went no further. Attackers penetrated at an endpoint, stole domain credentials, and gained access to servers and applications on our network, or none of the above.
In the meantime, while the crowd is answering, I want to say that regarding the reconnaissance, it's really hard to differentiate between, you know, a regular reconnaissance that's done by design by one of the apps that really needs to query the Active Directory to attackers that actually do the same. So just kind of the background when I mentioned that. Let me know when I can move forward.
Yeah, we just have a couple of more seconds and then we'll let everyone take a look. I think everyone's just about finished here. So basically we have 33% said that attackers tried to penetrate an endpoint but were unsuccessful. And then we had two-thirds of those who answered said none of the above. So let's move on.
Let's move on about, we were at the working, talking about the domain admin. So basically domain admin, if you gain domain admin, you just got access to everywhere in your organization, you know, service, application, database, file share, endpoints, everything is there. This is why it's so, you know, important for attackers to gain that. But another important thing that I want to mention is that attackers, before they are actually using the domain admin, they will find or search for ways to make sure their investment is being preserved. What do I mean by that? Is they will search for persistencies inside your domain in order to make sure that they will be able to come back. What do I mean by that? So if for example, you manage to detect the attackers, before they will use it, they will search for like backdoors or hooks that they can, you know, place inside your environment. So if someone will kick them out of your domain, they will be able to come back and, you know, use the same domain admin again. A lot of methodologies that attackers are using, they can create themselves a hidden domain admin that is valid for 30 years. So that's one example of all these kind of methodologies for attackers. So if you were able to detect them, they will come back again. Again, that domain admin is there again for 30 years. So we try to kind of deliver that message in with this metaphor that it's the ability, or when attackers get domain admin, you know, that part of the attack cycle is equivalent to steel sugar in hot water. So after the attack, after the sugar is melted inside the hot water, it's really, really hard to separate again the sugar from the water. And that's what happens to attackers once they get domain admin, and it's really hard to actually get rid of them. The main thing I would say to do after that happened is by literally rebuild the entire domain from scratch, as it's because of all the, you know, opportunities or persistencies, opportunities or dark corners inside your environment that attackers could hide and hide their backdoors, and they can always, you know, go back again and again and again. That's what we call kind of the infinite toxic loop of your enterprise is stuck in. So it's and the way to kind of, you know, break that loop, as I mentioned at the beginning, is to rebuild the entire domain from scratch. So the entire mission for our solution or for my team is being able to be fast enough and stop the attackers before they able to get domain admin. I'm not really into the game of after the attackers will get domain admin or raising an alert after the damage is done, and ask you guys to rebuild your entire domain as a solution. The main approach here is being able to stop the attack, stop the lateral movement attempt right at the endpoint before the attackers actually get domain admin. And as I mentioned, there is only 7 minutes. So we need to be really, really fast of doing it. And now you will see how we actually do that in the demo. So last thing that I want to mention before we go to the first demo that we kind of created for you guys here is that please keep in mind that there is a difference between endpoint that is connected to a domain and an endpoint that doesn't. Those that are connected to the domain pose a higher risk to your organization. And why is that? Is mainly because those that are connected to the domain have 100% visibility to your Active Directory database by design. And that's something that needs to keep in mind when you kind of trying to look on your all the security risk inside the kind of the organization. Carlos, you ready for the demo?
Yes, sir. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Perfect. So we're just going to take a couple minutes here for those in the audience that haven't seen kind of proof of how this works in the real world. Now, I've taken some liberties for the sake of time. We're not, you know, developing the malware that is, you know, creating the beacon to a command and control server, right? We're going to go ahead and go with the assumption that the attacker has already got that foothold, right? So he utilized some sort of zero day with a phishing scheme, and he got a beacon, you know, back to Russia or wherever he might be. So if he has a generic command and control connection, we're going to do some examples just off the command line so that you can see how the interaction works with the Windows APIs. Again, right, if this was sophisticated malware, this stuff could be embedded into things like WMI. It could be obfuscated. It could be, you know, called to process hollowing. The activity that's being done there is not what's important. What's important is that the Windows APIs will allow them to pull the information out of Active Directory. So if this beacon now comes up to me, as the attacker, I need to find out what it is that I've gotten a hold of, right? So we ask basic questions, you know, who am I, where am I, where do I want to go, how am I going to get there, right? Those are the basics. So we take a look here, we see that I'm somebody named Charlie. I'm in a domain called SYMC demos. I'm on a host called Win7Charlie. I begin to ask Active Directory questions. Give me more information about Charlie himself. So I can see that I'm authenticated to a particular domain controller where I exist within the OU structure, GPOs that are coming down, groups that I'm members of. We can see here that I am just a domain user, so I do not have elevated privilege within the domain. But that does not stop me from doing this type of reconnaissance and beginning to build a treasure map. So I'm going to do a basic query here to find out what the assets are in this domain. So basically, I asked Active Directory, tell me about all the domain computers. And we see a list here of about 50 things, right? For the sake of time, we can't spend an hour doing recon, but I can, you know, look at attribution of all of these assets. I can find out who's logged in where that machine is, the last time a password was changed, email addresses, everything that's being held within Active Directory are properties of these individual objects. But now as the attacker, right? I see that I've got a list of objects that I might be able to want to connect to, but Charlie, as a domain user, probably doesn't have access to that. So I'd go forward with saying, well, who does have access? I simply ask, you know, where do the God accounts? And I see that I've got 8 of them listed here. So if I could find any of these 8 accounts credentials on another system that Charlie has access to, I could access anything above. Now, first thing we might do is look locally in LSAS. So I'm going to use a tool called Mimikatz. This is a common, well-known piece of malware. It doesn't run in its native form anywhere. Anything should stop it, right? Even Google doesn't want you to download it. However, it's not about Mimikatz, right? It's the techniques that Mimikatz uses to crack open LSAS. Right? So those can be put into anything else, into some kind of zero day, in order to get in there and see the creds that are local to this machine.
Carlos, can I ask if you can make your little windows bigger? I'm getting some comments that folks can't see, and they are appearing very, very small in the console, so it's really, really hard to see what you're doing.
Let's see if I can, this will help any. I've got to fight with the real estate, so.
Okay, I think that's a little better.
Much better.
Yeah. Sorry about that. This should also help.
Yeah, that's okay. Much better.
So what I've done with the Mimikatz utility is essentially open up LSAS and ask it to dump the memory inside LSAS that holds all these creds. I can even do a process dump, right, and see a lot of this stuff just by combing through the memory that is dumped when you do that type of dump. But here, right, I'm doing it live, pulling it out of LSAS itself. And I see that I've got, you know, various accounts that have logged into this machine. So for instance, there's Charlie, who I'm logged in as. So this is where I might steal his hash and use that to log into another, you know, computer somewhere, even without knowing his clear text password. Now, Charlie's going to be limited to what he can see. If I had one of the accounts that was a privileged account, and we see here there's one called SSEM, which just so happens I have locally on this machine here. So I can steal this one. Again, it doesn't have to be local to this machine. I can find out where SSEM is logged into or has been logged into by using some other tools, and then hopping right with Charlie to another machine until I can get to the machine that has the account I need. But in this case, for the sake of time, we're lucky enough to have it right here. There's lots of different mechanisms that can be used for stealing creds. I'm going to do what's called a pass the hash. But I can do things like pass the ticket as well. What I've done is I've taken this hash value, right, for that user, and I've shoved it into another command window. What does that mean? Well, if we go back to my initial command window that I had here, when I first ran those queries, hang on a minute, because we were slow. There we go. So going back to this initial window, right, logged in as Charlie, I tried to go to the domain controller and look at the admin share. Can't do it. With Mimikatz, I took that hash value for that SSCM account and I shoved it into a new command window. Now I'm still logged in as Charlie, but this process is running with the authority of that SSCM account, and now I can see everything on the domain controller. All right, so this is just a quick example of how quickly a attacker can move laterally and take the domain controller, right? Because you have to be a domain admin in order to see the admin share on a domain controller, which is what I've done here. So I will pass it back over to you, Roi.
Amazing.
So I have a question. I think it's either for Roi or for Carlos. Does this security also protect the Symantec MDM solution?
So the MDM is the, I believe they're trying to talk about the mobile, is what they're asking about. The Threat Defense for Active Directory solution is protecting specifically Windows machines that belong to the domain. So phones would not be included in that.
And that's a reason to that. Again, you can't really do a recon to Active Directory, you know, from your mobile. Okay, so after that demo, basically in the demo you saw the problem, the fact that Active Directory is by design exposed from every endpoint connected to the domain. And because of that fact, when attackers land on an endpoint connected to the domain, they can move really easy and move laterally from endpoint to endpoint, from the endpoint to the DC, and really control your entire organization. I just want to mention, for kind of general knowledge, that there is an alternative, you know, for attackers. And the alternative for attackers is not using Active Directory in order to move laterally. And that alternative is searching for remote code execution for each and every move. So from every step, from every endpoint that they want to jump, they would need to do a research on finding a vulnerability, not just a vulnerability, a specific vulnerability that allow them to do that remote code execution for them to really control that endpoint. So see, you know, the path of resistance here. You know, the other alternative is so hard, is so expensive. So again, so for each and every jump, they would need to do that research and invest a lot of their time. And that's actually very noisy. And why doing that? This is why Active Directory is the least path of resistance inside your organization. And this is why all attackers are going that direction post-exploitation. Again, once they are in, Active Directory is the fastest way to get them to wherever they want to go. Okay, so let's talk about the solution and what we did here. So what we did here is, at the end of the day, is a solution that able to stop attackers in their first move. And how we do that is by obfuscating the Active Directory database, but at the endpoint side. So look at the screen before. This is what Carlos showed you. You do the reconnaissance to the Active Directory, you ask all your questions, Active Directory answer back. And what we do, we have an in-memory code that has the ability to obfuscate that data. So how does it actually works? Basically, once you install TDAT, if you are a SEP customer, you already got it. But in order to actually use it, you need to have another server, install another server, what we call the core, the J core. And that server basically goes to Active Directory and learns your Active Directory database. Then using artificial intelligence algorithm, we create much more information, fake information. So let's say you are a customer with 100,000 servers. Our JCore will go to your Active Directory, will pull that data, and will create a custom-made, fake objects that will now be, that will present to attackers around 1 million servers. So instead of 100,000 servers that you have, we will show 1 million fake servers to the attacker. So when attacker landed on the endpoint that connected to the domain, when he will try to do the recon that Carlos did, he will see, instead of 100,000 servers, he will see 1 million servers that created just for your environment. So each and every our customer has a different environment. So has a different environment, of course, and a different fake object that the AI algorithm created just for that specific environment. So by doing that, we literally flip the odds against the attacker. Now, once they will try to move laterally and try to act upon those fake servers, fake accounts, and steal them or access them, immediately we will catch them. We will catch them red-handed. We will catch them right at the endpoint. We will catch them at the first on their first move. And again, that will be immediately, not waiting for our algorithm to try to connect the dots and try to raise you an alert for you to go and try to understand what happened. You know, all that process that other companies are doing are, as I mentioned, really at the beginning, are slow. And what we have here is just 7 minutes. 7 minutes for the attacker to gain domain admin, for your enterprise to really be under their total control. So that's why we were had to think and had to come up with a way that really would be immediate. So, and we didn't kind of stop there. What we said is, in order to help the SOC, in order to really help, you know, closing the entire gap, after we managed to detect them really in time of seconds, we also automating the entire forensics gathering. So post-exploitation forensics is a little bit hard, a little bit different. If someone will do a reset to the endpoint, to the affected endpoint, we can lose a lot of important data that could affect your entire organization. So what we did is, once we saw that attackers are trying to work with one of the fake objects, we detect it, and we are immediately initiating a forensics investigation. So we go to that endpoint that we call the zero patient endpoint. We collect all the forensics information, and we gather it, and we show you here. This is kind of how it looked like. A full forensics report to show what the attackers did and all the other information that helps you with the investigation. And of course, we have the ability to stop it and create the mitigation, and we contain that affected process right at the endpoint, as I mentioned. That's for that, and in a second we will see it live in the demo. But I want to speak for another component that we have offered here with the Threat Defense or Active Directory solution, and this is called the breach assessment. So the breach assessment is separated solution. It's another kind of feature inside the Threat Defense for Active Directory suite. Is basically a breach attack simulation that would go and will search for all those misconfigurations inside your environment. Those that can literally lead to a total compromise, and show you a report. We will also see that in the Carlos in the next Carlos demo, which will show you how that report looks like. Basically, we analyze all the GPO, all the configurations, your Active Directory, and we try to connect those dots and show you, hey, if this and this and that is being configured the way it is, attackers can also use that in order to control your environment. And we explain how to actually close that gap. So actually very, very simple, really effective everywhere we go and everywhere we kind of, you know, used the breach assessment tool, we find a lot of those misconfigurations and even backdoors that attackers left behind, that we are able to help the customer and close it and, you know, reduce their attack surface. Carlos, please take it from here.
All right, I've tried to make my screen bigger before we got started here. So hopefully we don't have any issues with visibility this time. So the screen we're looking at now is a different desktop. Right, the first one we did, we didn't have any protection running on it. This one is protected by Symantec Endpoint Complete. As part of that, we have Threat Defense for Active Directory on. The scenario is still the same. We're going to assume something happened, some sort of zero day, a bad person has a connection to this machine. Right? So the back half of the MITRE kill chain. So same type of activities. I'm going to find out who I am as the attacker. This time I'm Amy. I'm in that same domain. I'm on a Win7-Amy box this time. Active Directory for information about her. And she's really the same type of user as Charlie was. Right, she's just a regular domain user. This is the same OU, connected to the same domain controller. Right, at this point, everything has been the same. What's different now is that when I begin to go do my recon, there we go. As the attacker, I'm now going to experience friction. Right, we're always trying to keep friction from the end user. How nice is it to turn that around and throw it back at the attacker? So this time, as I go through and I look for these domain computers, you can see, right, that I'm scrolling and scrolling and scrolling, right? Where before we had one screen worth of data. So to remind you what that looked like, the white screen is the domain data. So we had about 50 machines listed here. Again, the white screen is the real data. The attacker is seeing this black screen here, which is pages and pages of data. If I were to log onto the domain controller right now and do the same query, I would see what's on the white screen. We do not make any changes to the actual domain. We do not make any changes to the domain controller. We have zero impact on the production domain from that standpoint. On the endpoint, right, we have a much different experience. So as Roi said, we're protecting Active Directory from the endpoint. Essentially what we've done is a memory manipulation where we hook into the APIs that can be abused by the attacker. So there's no signatures involved with what we're doing here, right? We're not looking for a particular type of attack. We're not trying to match some known unknown type thing. All we're doing is connecting, hooking into every one of these APIs and manipulating the results to get returned, right? So if you came up with a new zero day, good for you, right? You did manage to somehow take this host. You're not going to have some type of different zero day to pull this information out of Active Directory. You don't need it, right? It's just the basic asking of those questions with the various APIs and protocols. So that's what we're hooked into. When you make that request, it goes out to the domain controller. When it comes back, we manipulate it, and then it's presented to you as the attacker. For all intents and purposes, it's pixels on a screen, right? None of this stuff exists. These are fake assets, right? Sometimes people wonder about honeypot type technologies. That is not what this is, right? Those create real fake assets. Something actually exists somewhere in the network, and you're trying to lure people to it. In our case, nothing exists anywhere except on the screen for this endpoint. A typical question is, well, does it look the same no matter which endpoint you get on? And the answer is yes. Right? So the mass data is the same on every endpoint that's being protected. We call all this fake data the mask. And you'll notice in this data, right, you see Cali, you'll see New York, Win7, HR, Finance, Laptop, New York City. It looks this way because that's what my original data looked like. So we have an AI that learns your environment, does the same recon an attacker would do, finds out everything there is to know, and then it creates the mask based on this data. So everybody's environment that is being protected looks different because it's all based on whatever your environment looked like in the first place. And again, these are not just the names of some machines. These are all virtual objects. We talked a little bit about attribution in the first demo. Same thing here. If I had the time, we could start looking at all the various properties, right? when we have, you know, red team tests go against our data, they'll look to see, well, were all these assets created on the same day? You know, have they logged in today? Has their password changed in the last week? Right? The answer is for everything, yes. Because what we're doing is we're duplicating all of your real data and then just tweaking, you know, little bits and pieces of it, right, to look like there's so much more here. And now for the attacker, right, I have a treasure map I'm trying to build that is, you know, 6-10 times too big. And if I interact with anything, I'm going to end up generating an alarm. So we haven't generated an alarm yet, right? The attacker has done some passive recon. We've given them some information. And now, right, what's he going to do with it? So interaction can be anything as simple as a ping, right? If I were to do a ping sweep against this, you know, environment, I'm immediately going to, you know, throw up an alarm. If I wanted to do a password spray against domain admins, I would immediately throw up an alarm. I'm not contained yet. We'll see if we can pull one more here. Oh, I'm already getting. Oh, no. Still got it. All right. So, as I mentioned, the domain admin side, we had 5 accounts when we looked at reality. Now I'm looking at 50. So I think there's all of these different accounts that I could try to steal credentials from. I can try to brute force one. I could password spray the whole group. But as soon as I try to log in as ADMPC, right, the first part of my script, I'm going to generate an alarm because ADMPC doesn't exist. And nobody's going to accidentally try to log into ADMPC unless they ran recon. Regular users don't run recon. Right, so it's a perfect trap, if you will, for that attacker. Now we can see here, as I try to continue to do my activities, I now suddenly get access denied. That is because we had a policy for automatic mitigation. So that's what it looks like to the attacker. Let's see what it looks like for the SOC. So this would be the main dashboard for Threat Defense for AD. I can see here I've got 5 real-time alarms. I've got 13 dark corner alarms. That's the assessment stuff that Roi was mentioning. When I drill in here, I have 1 new alarm today, April 1st, computer information gathering. When I click into it, I can see Win7 Amy executed a ping command. It went and hit 2 different masked objects. So we're gonna aggregate things in a script like this. You don't have, you know, 1,000 alarms. I can see, right, that she essentially was doing something here where she hit part of the mask. This is a basic type of alarm, right? You had an incident happen here, right? And you can get that. You can see that in the SUP console. You can see it within ICDX. We can send it to your SIM. You can see it there. What you're going to want is more detail. And my RDP seems to have locked up again. You're going to want more detail. I apologize. I don't know why we're not. There we go. I think I was having trouble with the browser and what I've done for trying to expand my real estate. So this is the forensic report for that alarm, right? Amy Win7, we just executed April 1st. We can see Amy is the person that has been compromised, right? We have a mini memory dump. We see a command shell. I had PowerShell running. We see the ping came out of the command shell. There's a blue lock on the command. As we saw, the attacker, right, got access denied messages. That's because automatic mitigation did that. I could also have manually mitigated it, right, from the SOC perspective. If I click on the process, I get process ID, path, MD5. It's not on virus total, it's just command shell. We didn't hit ER rules because we're not doing anything that interesting yet. And then as I scroll down, I even get to see my shell context to give me more context around the attack. So if it's a native shell that's getting invoked or used, we'll scrape whatever is out of memory and give that to you on the screen as well. Again, for the sake of time, I won't click through all of these tabs, but we have a lot of different tabs here where we're gathering that forensic evidence. And these reports are available to dump as a PDF or a JSON. So I could also have a sim come back and grab the JSON file if I wanted to try to digest everything in the forensic report. So let's jump back again to the attacker.
Carlos, can I just ask you a question while you're in the middle of that? We had a question that came in. Someone's asking, are any of the endpoints that you're demoing real?
In the list that we saw there, let me just show it to you again. So up here, we saw this gigantic list of assets. I said on the white screen, this was reality, right? So these are 50 real things that exist in this domain. They are still buried in here. So we're not removing anything, right? Because we don't want to break all the stuff that Active Directory needs to do for it to function correctly. So everything that is real is here, but it's buried. As the attacker, it's very difficult for me to know what's real and what's fake. And that's why I talked about the attribution. Right. If you know what you're doing, you're going to start looking at attribution and you can try to find out what's real and what's fake if it wasn't against our product. Right. With our product, it's not possible until you try to connect to it, at which point we now know the machine is compromised. So we're going to do Mimikatz like we did before. See if I can make it bigger. So again, the assumption here, right, is that I've used some sort of ODA and I can crack open LSAS. So this time when I pop into it, and we're seeing it scroll slowly here, but Amy just went by. That's who I was logged in as. Another account that went by was called Help Desk. Right here. We go back and look at our recon. We can see as well that Help Desk is in our list of domain admins right there. So as the attacker, I have the keys to the kingdom locally here in LSAS. There's no reason for me not to take it. Again, I could go through attribution, do everything I can to look up Help Desk and make sure it's legit domain admin. And all I'm going to find is that it is, because we're controlling reality for the attacker. The Help Desk account that was created here is a domain user. It's the only thing that we have you actually do with an Active Directory is create us one regular domain user, which we then mask to make it look like it's a domain admin. And it's real, and it really did log into this box. And essentially, I could steal it past the hash like I did before. We're kind of short on time, so I'm just going to go back to an alarm that's already been generated. So I did a past the hash here previously. Again, Amy wins 7. This time using Mimikatz, tried to steal the Help Desk credential out of memory. I come into the forensic report. I can see there was where Mimikatz was running. I can see the command shell that I spawned out of it with the Help Desk credentials. This time we see virus totals, you know, having a fit. YARA rules are matching. Again, not because Mimikatz.exe was used. That is not what our product is doing, right? In terms of this part of SES Complete, right? It's telling us we saw evidence of Mimikatz-like functionality within memory when we did the mini memory dump, right? So if it was obfuscated, hidden, right, it doesn't matter to us. The alarm's not generated based on the fact that something was using Mimikatz. It's something we're telling you after the fact. We seem to have found some evidence of Mimikatz-type activity. And again, through the shell dump, we can see the creds that were being pulled. There's Help Desk right there by the Mimikatz process. So if it was commodity malware where it's trying to spray and pray, it's absolutely going to grab this account as soon as it gets on the box, because it should be able to, you know, infect a whole organization with ransomware, at least at the PC level. It's not going to be able to do that because instead it's going to fail when it tries to move laterally, and you're going to get an alarm like this, thereby buying you time, right? Again, trying to stop that 7-minute type of excursion from happening or incursion from happening in that domain. Same thing if I was a targeted attacker, I'd be trying to grab that so I could bump myself along and get my privileges up higher. But as soon as I try to use it, even stealthily, that's going to cause an alarm like these to be generated. So that's the reconnaissance obfuscation that we just saw. The what we did with Mimikatz was seeing the credential that is buried in LSAS. And then the third, final thing is the dark corners. So as Roi mentioned, we do an assessment of the domain, meaning the domain security database, the domain controllers, and the actual endpoints. So depending on what check we're doing, depends on where it's going to run. So as an example, he mentioned like a backdoor. My real estate, I don't think I can get to it. I'll put it this way instead. No, there was one. So domain replication backdoor, this would be considered like a persistence mechanism, right? So as an attacker, I don't create another domain admin because I know you've got tools looking to say, hey, somebody's going to add to the domain admin group today. Probably going to get caught that way. Instead, I'll create a user Bob with the other, 100 people to get added today in the domain user group. But I'll give him a specific checkbox in his permissions called DC sync. That would allow me to escalate myself up later, right? So it's a method of a backdoor to where I can come back and make myself a domain admin later if you found, my current exploitation. So there are legit things that could need that. So this report will come back and tell you who has it, right? You can verify that's legit, take it out of the alarm, and then you'll just know if something new pops up with it. And again, that's just one example. The other thing that we wanted to show real quick was the portable version of this. So the product itself has these dark corners that run a continual basis, and they run across, again, like endpoints, domain controllers, not just domain database settings. The portable one is a more lightweight version that you can run by downloading a simple executable to any desktop, running it as any user. And this is the result of the report that you'll get. And it could take a couple minutes to, half an hour, depending on how big, your domain is. But it's going to give you a snapshot of your security posture in regards to Active Directory and give you some recommendations of things you could do to reduce your attack surface. So for instance, here, I can see that I have anonymous LDAP bind enabled on the domain, right? That's something that would allow me to, bypass some security controls and try to attack the domain. So we're letting you know, hey, that's there, it should be closed. These are privileged users that could be attacked, right? Are they all supposed to be there? Can you eliminate some of them? Local admin transversal means I've got some of the same passwords on the local administrator account throughout the domain, et cetera, as we scroll down. And again, this is something that you have access today if you have a SS Complete license without installing a TDAD server and everything involved with that. You can download this executable and in short order get a snapshot of your security posture within Active Directory.
Esther, would you like to ask something?
We have a couple of questions that came in. Is there a lead time after installation before Symantec Threat Defense for Active Directory actually starts working?
No, it would be active as soon as you do the install of the server and push out the policy to the agents.
Okay. And we did have a question, can I run the breach assessment myself? I think that you did answer that. About how long does it take from start to finish?
It's totally dependent on the size of the domain. So like in my little test lab, it runs within a few seconds. On a, you know, production domain of, let's say, 10,000, I've seen it take 5 minutes. So you can extrapolate that out depending on how big you are as to how long it could take. But it's really dependent on the organization and how big their AD database is.
Okay. I think that's all the time we have today for questions. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. And before you sign off, please take a moment to rate today's webinar and download the materials in the attachments tab. Our next webinar is in our endpoints security series. It's going to be in 2 weeks, and it's going to be on Thursday, April 15. And that's focused on threat intelligence, and it will be led by Adam Licata and Kevin Haley. And you won't want to miss that. The link to sign up is in the attachments tab. So thank you, everybody, for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again in our next webinar. Have a wonderful day.
Thanks, all.
Thank you, guys.